Democracy, popularity, and scandal. All three words that could really describe any presidential election. But behind all the drama and the craziness are issues that will impact our nation perhaps for many, many years to come. Can the new administration win over the millennial hearts? This is what I wish you knew about the battle for the ballot. Everyone, I'm Yasmeen, and welcome to I Wish You Knew. From election season to the new administration, the media is always buzzing about presidential politics, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And now with one party controlling both houses of Congress and the White House, many are wondering what's in store for the next 4 years. Can the new administration calm millennial concerns? Here to tell you what they wish you knew are...
My name is Adam.
Hey, it's Byron.
My name is Janet.
So let's just get right into it, folks. How has electing a new president after 8 years of one president, one administration, how does that impact us? How has that impacted the country?
Sure. I mean, I think right after the election results came in, you know, a lot of people, especially people in our generation, were shocked. And it was kind of, you know, definitely a wake-up call. And you generally see, I think, you know, every 8 years, a change of, you know, parties that take over the White House. But I think in this, you know, in this scenario, people were really upset because Hillary, you know, she won the popular vote, but she lost the Electoral College. Yeah. And so now you have people, you know, questioning the legitimacy of the Electoral College.
Exactly. Right. And this is not new. I mean, this has happened before, right?
Plenty of time. Mm-hmm.
Of course.
Yeah. And I'm going to jump in there, Adam, to second that. I think especially for people who it was their first time voting, this was kind of like, you know, their first time getting their hands on the actual, you know, voting process and the nitty-gritty of politics. And to see something like this happen, I feel like it discouraged a lot of people, but it kind of gave them a wake-up call to, you know, this is what to expect for years to come. So, you know, 8 years of seeing the same, you know, same guy, Obama, and then now 4 years of, like, this totally, like, not even his doppelganger, just this totally off the wall character, and you know, it's gonna be interesting. I feel personally.
Yeah, I mean, I think the change in political parties shouldn't have been a huge surprise, because even throughout the Obama administration, it was a very clear indicator that the Tea Party became a, you know, some sort of uprise because of things that they were unhappy about, and then, you know, the Congress was pretty much Republican dominated throughout Obama's administration. So I'm not entirely shocked that we have a Republican candidate and a Republican, you know, Congress, but the candidate itself is questionable. but, you know, I think that we really, if we really dip into, like, you know, populist vote versus electoral college, we have to really look at, you know, why is this happening, and why did it happen in 2000? Why is it happening in 2016? That there is a disparity there, and should we really shift to a full out populist vote, or does the electoral college actually, is it something that works, but maybe in theory it's great, but in practice maybe not so much?
Right. Okay. So we're talking about, you know, electoral college versus popular vote. So what is electoral college? What is popular vote? You know, what are the differences? What are the similarities? You know, why is this important?
Sure. So the popular vote, it's pretty simple. Whoever gets the most votes wins. The electoral college is a little bit more complicated.
Well, not whoever gets the most votes wins, right?
For the popular vote.
Okay, but that doesn't necessarily mean they win, or do you mean?
They would win the presidential election.
Ideally, if that was the system in place and determinant for it. So I think he's just saying, like, what would happen in, like, the popular vote case and what would happen in the electoral vote case.
Yes. Yeah. Popular is the most wins. Electoral is a little bit more complicated, but I'll let you take that away, Adam.
Sure. So each state has a certain amount of electors, usually determined by the state, the size of the state. And, you know, so when we're going to the ballot, yes, we're, you know, choosing Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton, Gary Johnson, those names. But it wasn't until, you know, December 19th did the election actually become official, when all the electors were in a room and officially casted their ballots. Mm-hmm. And, you know, like Byron was saying, some people really discouraged by this entire election, you know, not only because, like, the result, but because their vote didn't, they feel that their vote didn't count. There were seven electors that were supposed to vote for the candidate that the people chose, and they instead voted for other people, including a Native American activist.
Right.
I mean, it's great that she got a vote, but, you know, it's, yeah.
So we just have a few minutes left. So, you know, what would you say, what is your, you know, advice in terms of, you know, voting and this idea that the popular vote doesn't necessarily determine
I would say stay
the
educated.
Winner.
Like, you can... You can't go wrong with education. Like, the more you know, the more you grow, the more knowledgeable you are. Just get educated on what it means to vote, on what politics is. Like, I feel like a lot of people just don't have a general idea of how this democracy works. You know, they just think that one guy's at the top, that's it. It's not how it is. You got to get educated. You got to get involved. You got to stay active. And, I mean, you'll hopefully, you know, make change for yourself.
Yeah. Jen, 30 seconds.
Yeah. In theory, again, the Electoral College really should work. It should be fair and sound to represent both big and large, small and big states. Mm-hmm. However, you know, I think the issue is that folks don't understand that you can't just vote in the presidential election. You have to vote every year. Your state, your local, whatever elections it is, you have to get active. Those are the votes that actually win by popular vote. And they're the people who will soon determine who the Electoral College will be made up of. And if you know, school systems aren't educating new voters about that kind of thing, how can we expect that people will not get angry when they kind of don't really know what's going on? And I feel like that, in a way, is slightly an unintentional voter suppression sometimes. But, you know, I just feel like Byron said, people really need to get educated, because we just have to understand our schools aren't going to provide that education. And because it's not like, go to Google, just do the research, understand why there is an electoral college, and like why in maybe practice it's not necessarily working.
This is getting really good, but we have to take a break. But first, riddle me this. Which founding father is on the $100 bill? Stay tuned to see if you're right. Welcome back to I Wish You Knew. We're talking about politics and voting.
So I definitely like to put voter suppression on the table. I think it's very important when it comes to not just this past election, but as we move forward in future elections. I work for an organization, OCA, Asian Pacific American Advocates, a national social justice organization specifically for the Asian American and Pacific Islander community. And a lot of voter suppression issues that the community really deals with is not poll workers not knowing the actual laws. So due to Section 235, you're actually allowed to bring anyone to go into the booth with you if you're a limited English speaker, and have them be an interpreter or translator for you in the booth. So for example, when I was little, my mother would take me into the booth so I can read and let her know what's on the ballot and help her with the machine. So a lot of poll workers actually, they just don't actually know. That's actually the law, and so they'll turn people away because even just the basics of checking in at the desk before voting, like, they're like, well, you can't speak English or you don't understand, but that's really not the case. Or when they bring in interpreters, like, oh, no one could go in the booth with you, they just really don't know. And so there's actually a really cool hotline that was created. It's API Vote, and, you know, they help people with those things. And sometimes we'll even talk to the poll workers and be like, no, this is actually allowed and it's not voter fraud. But there's ways of suppressing votes and deterring people from the polls because of things like that. And it's something that the community is really working on, and we want to make people aware. It's like, no, it's actually people can come to the polls with those options available to them.
I see. Yeah. And those who are working the polls, is there any training? Do y'all know, is there any training before they work the
polls? It's different in every area, but my understanding, it's only like a day or two training because it's volunteer-based. And the rule is that you're really supposed to have about 50-50 representation who works the polls, so 50% Democrats, 50% Republicans, but there are certain areas where you can't get that kind of representation, right? So that turns into the other levels of voter suppression.
Yeah, I actually worked the poll for the first Obama election, volunteered for that. And it was real interesting. I feel like another point, just gonna slide that on this couch. A lack of information could also be a form of voter suppression because, like Janet was saying, you know, the people did not know these policies. They did not know that these were, this was something that was, you know, allowed. And, you know, if someone who could barely speak or write English goes in there and they just see a bunch of, you know, letters, they just go check any box, you know, not, you know, cognitively thinking, you know, how this could affect them. They're just gonna, you know, but I feel like a lack of information is like a big, big, big thing, because if you don't know, then I mean, you fail ultimately, you know.
And if these people that are working the polls, if they're just volunteers, they could have alternative motives. They could judge people based on outside characteristics and, you know, maybe give them like the wrong information about how to fill out a ballot, which is a dangerous possibility.
Yeah, and it was like just a day. Like I remember getting up, and I went in there, and it was just like set up these tables, set this up, and that's it. There was really no, like, you know, this is what you tell people, and this, like, they had a line monitor, and they had somebody to collect the ballots. I mean, but they all looked like, you know, people who were just upset. Really, there was really no formal training. So I think, you know, let's go ahead and implement that somewhat and just inform the people a little bit more so that, you know, everybody could grow.
What about, I'm sure that you all have seen in the newspapers or, you know, on the news in terms of these voting IDs, right? Mm-hmm. In some states, I'll say two things. One, like with the Voting Rights Act, you know, we know that some states, you know, have either detracted, you know, this act. And so now states don't necessarily have to get approval from, I don't know, I'm assuming Congress, to be able to change some of their policies regarding what are the requirements for me when I go to vote. And so that includes IDs, you know, government issued IDs, but what if you're not able to obtain a government ID? Because that is a intense process, and you have to have birth certificate, secure social security card. It's intense. So what are some of your thoughts?
There's like, voting ID laws are just getting out of hand, and that happened due to the last redistricting that happened and with the amendment that happened in the Voting Rights Act. And so there are states like Washington State where it's just all mail-in ballots. Everyone gets a ballot mailed to them, and they don't even have voting polls. You just mail it in. And it's so easy, right? Like, all you can do is check a piece of paper and just mail it back in. But then there's places like the state of Virginia where their ID laws are so complicated, one person can bring in their employee badge ID and somehow be allowed to vote, but someone who brings an actual ID or might seem suspicious or might not have the right address, but they're still living in the state of Virginia, be turned away. So, you know, it's those voter ID laws are creating voter suppression and just really creating this mess. Like, I just don't understand why, like, voting is not a privilege that's awarded to be easy, but making it that much more difficult for folks. You know, with like the Asian American community, like, a lot of people have their own small businesses and work, and getting out to the polls are difficult, so that's why we've been pushing those absentee ballots to the folks. Mm-hmm. But people, again, education, knowledge, things like that, may not know about those things, but they also just know going to the polls are so difficult for all the reasons you listed of like trying to, you know, just being able to vote. And also just like my own tippet, I love the one where it's like, oh, I don't want to register to vote because I don't want jury duty. Actually, if you get have a driver's license, you're still going to do jury duty.
Yeah. Anyway, I don't want to jinx it.
I've been called twice.
They didn't call me.
Yeah, I mean, you can't, so, you know, according to Vox, you know, you can't blame voter suppression for the outcome of the election. They did a study and they found that, you know, voter suppression in the swing states, you know, could not have determined an alternate outcome. Mm-hmm. However, you know, Martin Luther King III actually met with Donald Trump, I think a few months ago, actually, right after MLK Day, and they're talking about how, you know, with vote in regards to voter ID laws, how there can maybe be a, you know, a free government ID, mm-hmm. You know, photo ID that you could then use at the polls.
Right.
More on the battle for the ballot after the break. But be sure to tell us what you think by using the hashtag IWYK, I wish you knew. Welcome back, and thanks for staying with us. So now that we've talked about some of our hopes and fears, what can we do as millennials to be the change that we want to see? And I'll say that, you know, with midterm elections coming up in 2018, there will be 55 seats in the Senate that are up for grabs. So it's really, really important that we...
I mean, I've been saying this whole show, information. That's because I'm a stickler for that. I mean, if you're informed, right, mm-hmm. you'll be a part of something. You know, now you're active, and now that you're active, you're starting to think about these different types of, you know, solutions and different types of having these different types of thoughts, which drives other things. So, I mean, if you know, that's like the basic. Like, just know about it, and then that way you can start having feelings about it, start having opinions about it, and becoming active to make change. Because if you don't know anything, you don't know, you know?
Well, how will we know, you know? Like,
so I have a message to those who are very unhappy about how this past presidential election turned out, is like, stay angry, but stay angry by knowing who to talk to.
Exactly.
You need to start talking outside of your spaces. You need to start talking to people and appealing to those people, mm-hmm. relating and connecting with storytelling. You have to use your own personal experience to tell them why this is so important to you, to send the message. I think what we really missed out in is that we just stayed with our friends, we stayed with our families, instead of going out to those people who honestly have just said, I don't think I was heard. I don't think anyone was hearing me. And like getting out of our comfort zones, find a local group in your area who's really fighting their resistance in a way, and just latch on to them and work with them and work really hard these next 2 years, and maybe 2018, just might be a different story.
Advocacy groups are gonna play a huge role. You know, finding an issue that you really care about, and, you know, volunteering your time and money, really, you know, dedicating, you know, to the cause. I have a friend that's a speechwriter in New York, and he said that, you know, it's a liberal group it's a liberal speechwriting firm, and he said that they're doing a lot more advocacy work because they feel the need to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we're going to be seeing that, of course, over the next 4 years.
Like, fight your state. That's what it is. It's everything in the state right now, because like you said, those seats are open, and it's mm-hmm. not really about fighting the president necessarily, mm-hmm. but fighting those state issues that will make that bigger difference overall.
Because exactly. He still has to answer to someone. I think that's what a lot of people like to forget, you know? I mean, he's there, but I mean, he can't do everything by himself. So, you know, as long as you get people, you know, who's in your corner, you know, represented on those levels, then I think, you know, that'll bring about the biggest long-term change.
Yeah, I mean, people are, you know, people are spending. You have to do more than just vote every 4 years, every 2 years.
Exactly.
I mean, you have to get involved. I know a lot of people that have made donations to Planned Parenthood in Mike Pence's name.
Right.
I think that's pretty funny.
Yeah.
You know, it's pretty ironic. So just, you know, getting involved and, you know, joining advocacy groups and, you know, fighting the good fight.
Yeah. Stay strong. Stay active. Stay vigilant.
Yeah. I say, again, stay angry, but use that anger for good, because that's really just how we're going to get through. And, you know, whatever your cause is, whatever side you are on, like, just make sure, like, your experiences are being heard and not being overshadowed by just, like, overwhelming media and things like that. Like, your story actually means something.
Exactly. So. You have Twitter thumbs. Use those Twitter thumbs. Use those Facebook thumbs. Use whatever medium that you have, whatever outlet you have to get that information out there and just, you know, be heard. You know, you can be heard. Like, I don't want to hear anyone in this day and age say you can't be heard, because there's YouTube, there's Snapchat, there's everything. Just get your voice out there.
So I have a question in terms of, so what do you think are some of the concerns that millennials have? I know I have a huge concern for education, right? And, you know, there was this talk about getting rid of the Department of U.S. Education.
Yes.
That is a big no for
that
me.
Is
no,
crazy.
We're not doing that.
No.
But, you know, what are some of the concerns?
I think for the overall picture, environmental issues is actually probably one of the overall concern for specifically millennials, because at the end of the day, it's like we have all these other issues that are equally as important, but it's like if we don't have a planet to live on, what are we fighting for, right?
Exactly.
But also, I think education also definitely super important, and also immigrants. There's people always forget about the younger youth and student immigrants who are here who are undocumented, and folks that don't have representation. And so joining like advocacy groups and stuff and really promoting their issues and sharing their stories and making it actual, you know, primetime TV worthy news is, I think, what's super important.
Yeah, and climate change is tough because we're not, you know, it doesn't necessarily affect our daily lives as much as some other issues, as much as the economy and healthcare and some other issues. And it's especially frustrating when you have, you know, the person that's gonna be the head of the EPA who is, you know, he's in his 60s or 70s, and it's not really, you know, climate change is not gonna affect his life as much as it's gonna affect our life, our generation.
Exactly.
So it's, you know, it's just super frustrating, and it's another excuse to get involved.
I mean, what I learned about America, as a whole, is I was listening to a comedian, I forgot his name, it escapes me at this moment, but he said, he's like, here in America, somebody's always gonna agree. He said, back in the 50s, like, yo, we want civil rights, you know, we want, you know, the right to be civil. And it was just, you know, those group of people were like, no, I don't think they should have it, you know, not at all, no, you know. So it's always gonna be somebody to disagree. But as long as you're getting up and doing something and being active, I mean, you know, invoking that change.
Thank you all so very much for your input. I think this was a very, very enlightening discussion about voting and voter suppression. That's all the time we have for this edition of I Wish You Knew. Thanks for watching. But before we go, panel, did you guess the answer to the trivia question?
Was it Benjamin Franklin?
All about the
Benjamins.
Benjamin Franklin is the one on the $100 bill. That is correct.
Yeah.